Okay, we will have maybe a little bit of like a break for this round table because we have a reference to the last year's round table. The topic last year, or the title of last year's roundtable, was Humans Make Nature. It was our idea to invite different professionals and experts from different disciplines for discussing the Anthropocene. We did afterwards documentation of all the lectures held last year. This was, for example, Matt Edgeworth, an archaeologist, and it was Heather Davis who did this lecture about the plastics and the afterlives. There was Christian Schwegler, who introduced us to the... who introduced us to the idea of the Anthropocene in the widest idea of it. And in the book, we have also artistical contributions, and we are very happy about this. One of the artists, Claudia Merzendorfer, is here right now. And together with the graphic designer, where is Nicole Six, did the graphic design, and I'm very happy that she insisted so much in these different papers and having the artist's contribution in it. And she really invented different ideas how to deal with this artistic contribution we had at the former space of the Abteilung für ortsbezogene Kunst. Therefore, this book is very alterating of ideas, of speeches, and of knowledges and voices in this reader. And I think it's a very interesting compilation out of how to deal with this topic. I'm here also to thank some people. I mean, Heather, Matt, Gloria, and Christian are not here this year. But, for example, Claudia is here, and we have Christian Meyer and Hermann Peinitz also in the book. I would like to thank them too. Nicole over there for the graphic design. And also Georgia Holz is over there. She did the editing of the whole volume. Thank you very much for your ongoing energy for it. We are today here to discuss furthermore, the Anthropocene, and I'm very happy that I'm able to welcome Michael Wagreich. He is professor for sedimentology and geology here at the University in Vienna. And he is some of these guys who is drilling and looking into the past in stones, and he has renewed some of these methods to date some sediments, and he dealt also with the climate change, who took like millions of years ago. So he is very aware of all the environmental impact and maybe imprints we are leaving as humans on Earth. He is also a member of the Anthropocene Working Group, that is a discussing panel within
not
the
discussion, but
okay, you will.
I will go into
You will tell us. The only Austrian member of this Anthropocene Working Group, they are discussing if we are in the Anthropocene, if it's useful to have the Anthropocene, or when it should begin, and things like that. So thank you very much for coming and giving us some idea of this discussion, which is going on. Thanks.
Okay. So, thanks for invitation, and you see it's already dark. This is one of the icons of the Anthropocene. I'm sure you have seen that. It's my first talk about the Anthropocene in front of artists, so I hope you will enjoy it a little bit. So yeah, there is a content. So in the end, I hope I will not take too much time. I will go to some problems, future paradigms that are changed with the name Anthropocene, and some question marks. In principle, why I am here for the Anthropocene and why I'm talking about Anthropocene stuff is I'm a geologist, and immediately when I heard the term Anthropocene for the first time, I thought that is rubbish. That doesn't interest me as a geologist. I'm dealing with 100 million years old rocks, and what's that stuff about? So, but later on, I just made some research into literature for my stratigraphy lectures. And so the end of the stratigraphy lectures, you're going from the old to the young, through the Earth history. In the end, I came to the Anthropocene, and I had to think of that, and I thought, okay, there is something. And after some time, I became a member of this Anthropocene working group. This is a very formal working group, so it's not only discussion. It's that real Anthropocene working group. Because we are a working group of the Subcommission on Quaternary Stratigraphy. Quaternary is the youngest time interval of Earth history, so the Ice Ages beginning about 2.6 million years ago. And this Subcommission on Quaternary Stratigraphy is a subcommission of the International Commission on Stratigraphy, the real timekeepers of the geological timescale. And that International Commission on Stratigraphy is only one body of the International Union of Geological Sciences, IUGS, which is the international union of geologists, or all geosciences. Every 4 years there is a congress, only every 4 years. So only every 4 years we have news. Sorry. And at that congress, we have decisions on time intervals, on so-called stages, epochs of the geological timescale. So there are about 35 people or 40 people within that Anthropocene working group. Most of them are earth scientists, which speciality as geologist or paleontologist, geochemist, stratigrapher, and so on. There are some earth system scientists, which is a little bit different. I will come back to that at the end. And there are geographers, there are archaeologists. Matt Edgeworth is also into that. There is a science journalist, there's a lawyer for international law within that body. And my main message at the start is that there are many Anthropocenes. So all social sciences, humanities, history, archaeology, and geology, of course, have their own Anthropocenes. And what the Anthropocene Working Group of IUGS is dealing with is, of course, only the Anthropocene of the geologists, of the geoscientists. There are a lot of words that go around, from Capitalocene to technofossils, end of nature, and so on. So the first statement of the Anthropocene Working Group was humans have altered geologic processes across the Earth system sufficiently to cause a planetary transition to a new interval of geological time. So at the start of the working group, there were really a lot of skeptical people within that working group, but doing research, geoscientific research into that topic, we recognized that, okay, there is something going on, and we see it already in our strata, in our geological record. So you know the background already, and there are these fine diagrams where you see you have the Holocene. This is the formal, still valid last interval of geological time. And it seems that we have left this Holocene envelope of climate, Earth system behavior, and going into a new one, which you may call this Anthropocene. But a little back to the plane geology, plane stratigraphy. I hope you are not too bored, but how do we come to a decision, or what's that all about? So this is the geological timescale, the last version I was able to get. I'm not so used to Mac. 4.6 billion years, beginning of Earth as a planet. And here is the youngest side, the Holocene, as the last interval, the last epoch of this geological timescale. And this is something that not everybody can change. So there is this body of IUGS, the International Stratigraphic Commission, and the subcommissions, and only working groups are allowed to work on changing this timescale. Because geologists are very conservative, of course, and they need a stable timescale for the Earth history, for the work. So there is not, you don't change that for fun. Let's say it like that. And the timekeeper of the geological timescale is the International Stratigraphic Commission. And there is a certain process. How do you define and how can you change the timescale? So this is the so-called GSSP thing. This is a global boundary stratotype section and point. Looks very, sounds very strange, I think. But this is just, how can we define an age? We cannot define an age because ages can be measured only with methods of physics, chemistry. And those methods are going better, improve, so the ages are not stable, are still not stable really. So what we do is we define the base of a stage. We define the stage by the base, which is good for the Anthropocene because the end of the Anthropocene would be hard to define. So the base of the Anthropocene, or the base of a stage, is defined by a GSSP. This is a point within a section anywhere on the globe. We do not use Moon or others at the moment, but a point in a section, so a point in a rock record. And then after that, we go there and measure and have some methods to get an absolute age, as we call that, so 55.2 million years. There's a large error on that. And if you are ready to have a proposal like that for a GSSP, for a point, for a base of the Anthropocene in that case, you have to go to your subcommission and they will vote on that. And then it goes to the International Stratigraphic Commission and they will vote on that. And only if those votes are positive, have a majority, the stage is really now a formally defined new or changed stage of the geological timescale. And those votes are only possible for the Global Commission, for the International Commission, every 4 years on those congresses. And the last congress was now in Cape Town, South Africa. And that's why I'm sitting here, probably, to tell the news about the Anthropocene. And I have to disappoint you, it's not defined yet. So we will have to work another 3 years and have a proposal in 4 years in New Delhi in India at the next congress. And those are called chronostratigraphic units, and stratigraphy is the discipline that deals with that time scale. Just for an example, definition of the Holocene, which is still valid by now, is with a GSSP something like a point or a level within an ice core that was drilled from Greenland, northern part of Greenland. It is kept in Copenhagen, and it looks like that, and there are some chemical markers that have some wiggles, curves, things like that, peaks, and within some of that peak, this boundary is set. This is the GSSP, and only later on, the ice layers were counted, and it was 11,700 years before present, which means before year 2000 in that case. And the error of the counting is plus minus 80 years. So if we have an Anthropocene beginning with 1950, those 80 years of the error of the Holocene are already in the range of an Anthropocene. Coming to the conclusion of the Anthropocene Working Group, we made a report for the Cape Town Congress, and there were the question for the geological Anthropocene: is the Anthropocene stratigraphically real? So is it geological real? And there was a vote before that within the working group, and 34 of 35 people said yes. Most of the key Earth system changes identified have left a variety of stratigraphic proxy signals. And the potential Anthropocene stratigraphic unit is thin, of short duration, but distinct and globally widespread. So the global trash layer, you can name that. Many of the changes that we see from the Holocene to an Anthropocene are long-lived or irreversible. So the working group came to the conclusion the Anthropocene is potentially a valid unit of the geological timescale. The question is, should the Anthropocene be formalized? There are terms around for stratigraphy that are not really formalized. So you can use them, but nobody really knows how it is defined. But we say yes, it should be formalized, 30 of 35 people from the working group. Some key stratigraphic signals clearly exceed the stable Holocene and Quaternary range, and some signals are novel in Earth history. The big question is for the base and the beginning of the Anthropocene, and the maturity, but in that case it's not a real good maturity. Substantial of the working group, substantial and globally synchronous changes to the Earth system most clearly intensified in the great acceleration of the mid-20th century. So that would be a pragmatic position for a base for a start of the Anthropocene. But we need a formal proposal on that, and we need this GSSP thing, a section on the world where it is continuous and we see a change at 1950, 1960s, somewhere in that time range. Conclusions that came out of that: humans influence and have influenced significantly geological processes. So there are the carbon cycle, nitrogen, sulfur cycles are changed. The system of erosion, transport, sedimentation, deposition is changed via dams and things like that. There are even human-induced earthquakes. And the geological Anthropocene is defined by global change that is pinned down in Earth history. So we are not dealing with today's change, but we are dealing with the change that is already archived in the Earth history, in the, let's say, rock record. So signals of that change can be found globally in the geological archive. And thus, this change has to be part of the geological timescale and part of stratigraphy. There is an internal geological controversy about that, because conservative geologists call that would be a bad decision, because there is the political influence and the political, political Anthropocene. And Stan Finney, who was the former chair of the ICS, of this Stratigraphic Commission, said, what you see here, it's becoming a political statement. That's what so many people want, and he doesn't want to have a political statement dealing with the Anthropocene. Just go on and don't comment on that to save some time. So what are the key signals? And I think that was already discussed in some of those discussions on plastics and archaeology record are within the book, which is a very nice one. So there is the summary of key signals. There is noble materials, aluminium, concrete, plastic, minerals, fuel ash, artificial deposits. There are chemical signals with climate change, nitrogen cycles, and so on. And there are biological signals. And I will very rapidly go through that just to remind you on those things that you see. Anthropogenic materials, what's noble, aluminium, enough aluminium to wrap the whole US in aluminium foil. Concrete, large, after the 1940s, end of the Second World War, large rise. Plastics, of course, enough plastic to wrap the whole world within plastic. Even with the stratigraphy, the carbon cycle, a lot of change. So you have here 1600, 1800, 2000. Here we are today. And you see carbon isotopes going down rapidly. And you see this is inverse to the rise in carbon dioxide. And there is also the biological change that is going on. We are at the beginning of a sixth mass extinction. So that's our vertebrates here. And you see the extinction rates that start somewhere between 1800 and 1900 to go up and go up more and more. There are Anthropocene rocks. There's this beautiful beach rocks cemented by plastic at Hawaii. There are Anthropocene landmarks, a big heap of debris, the Teufelsberg formation. It's already a geological formation. But in fact, the debris of the Second World War in Berlin that's piled up to a big, mountain, hill. The stratigraphic definition for the Anthropocene, when should it start? There is still a debate on that. I'm more a friend of an older definition of the Anthropocene to have anthropogenic sediments within that definition. But as I said, the main bandwagon of the commission of the group goes into 1945 to 1964, somewhere in that time, definition of the base. And that's really the great acceleration where you have a lot of things that start around this 1950 year, so accelerating in high rates. Even you have McDonald's restaurants here starting around a little bit before 1950 or at 1950, whatsoever. We are not sure what marker. Every base, every definition, every GSSB needs a certain marker. What is the marker for the Anthropocene? You can think of plastic, some type of plastic. You can think of concrete. The best marker from the geological viewpoint would be radiogenic fallout signatures from those bomb spike if you use the 1950-1960 age for the base. Plutonium-239 is maybe the best one because those others are already gone out of the system, but this one will stay for at least 100,000 years within the sediments. And the spike, this is the blue one of the plutonium, would be around 1964 or something like that. So there were some questions that I was told I may think of concerning the Anthropocene and the geological sciences as a whole. Are there any future scenarios out of the geology? So one of them would be the atmospheric lifetime of the anthropogenic CO2. So this would be the duration of the Anthropocene, you can call that. And by burning all the fossil fuels that we have stored or that nature has stored within Earth history, we come to the conclusion that to pull that down again from the atmosphere via the ocean, via reaction with limestone, via reaction with igneous rocks, that's mainly weathering, this needs at least around 40,000 years to get the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere with natural weathering, natural processes. Future scenarios out of geology, what's the fate of plastic? There were recently in Spiegel Online, there was an author who claimed that plastic decays on the long time and thus doesn't stay in the geological archive. That's a nice note, but yeah, it's totally wrong. I couldn't believe that. So it doesn't stay in the geological archive. So where does it go then? Into the outer space? So plastic is essentially our carbon compounds made of fossil fuel, which are hydrocarbons. Plastic is stable for shorter time scales, so they are technofossils, especially in the archaeological record. But geologically, under higher temperature and pressure, and I'm sure there will be some bacteria that like plastic in a long time, so it is unstable on longer time scales. Of course, it will not stay as plastic within the rock record, but being buried below strata, plastic will thus go through a transformation process to become hydrocarbons again. So that's the fate of the plastic. To get back into the circle, into the cycle, just as planktonic organisms did million years ago. So don't forget, it's all organic chemistry. We call that organic chemistry. When we deal with plastic, it's already, it's becoming organic again. So it's a natural cycle, and the problem is that this takes some several millions of years at least in nature to bury those plastic things, to change them, to change the organic molecules into shorter ones, to break them off and to get probably future fossil fuel out of that. So it's not, it stays in the geological archive, I'm sure. Another question was, does the Anthropocene change the earth sciences, the geology? So is there a vice versa effect? Yes, of course, it was already, because earth science and stratigraphy became earth system sciences. So there was a big change with the International Geosphere Biosphere Program that looked on Earth as a whole, as a system, and changes within that system, and the Anthropocene, the word Anthropocene actually came out of that. Not all of the Earth scientists, of course, made that change. So they are staying still as in earth sciences, but earth system science became a new discipline with new journals. So even the AGU, the American Geophysical Union, also one of those unions of geologists and geophysics, probably conservative, they have a new journal for some years now, which is called Earth's Future, which is something that geologists in former time didn't think of, I have to admit. And there's this good and bad Anthropocene trajectories for future time that we are thinking of. So this is one of the changes that the earth sciences went through. Another one on paradigms. Are there any paradigms ruined? Of course, there is a big paradigm, uniformitism, in the end of the 18th century. James Hutton, Charles Lyon, very famous people from Great Britain. Uniformitism, a key first principle of geology. The present is the key to the past. We have heard that, we have lectures about that, but now we know that the present is not anymore the key to the past, because we see a present that is that was never realized in Earth history. And things that develop today, we cannot find them in Earth history. So if our coastlines are sinking because of human-induced subsidence at rates that have never been seen before, or seismicity is becoming controlled by human action in parts of the world where fracking dominates, the present is not the key to the past anymore. Yeah, the Anthropocene changes the relationship between natural sciences and society also, on a broader sense, not only for geology. Natural sciences as a whole become now reversed for an evolution for about 500 years with Copernicus and Darwin. Humans are no longer passive observers of the Earth, and they may be a geological superpower, although I don't like the term superpower in that case, but we are a geological power somehow. Linear direction of time, geology looks only into the past, not as Earth system scientists. We look for the past, for the future, look what's going on today. And geological modeling, of course, we have analog and numerical models, looks into the future, but predicts future conditions. And as a geologist, we then can look on those future conditions, on those possible future conditions and environments, and that we can test with the geological past. And so some kind of time fuzziness or even maybe reversals may be evident. And I want to conclude with something that was written down in 1899, so maybe well before the Anthropocene. When the work of the geologist is finished and the final comprehensive report written, the longest and most important chapter will be upon the latest and shortest of the geological periods. So he didn't name Anthropocene, but of course that's the Anthropocene. Thanks.
Thanks so much. You did more work on remodeling the lecture as I thought, but thanks very much. We heard that the past is hounding the present, something like that in your lecture, and now like something like the future is hounding the present, or even the scientists for looking into the past. I think that's a really nice time machine circle we are now in it. But I would like to ask first, are there any questions from the audience to?
Yeah. I'd be interested in what you what is defined as the good and the bad Anthropocene. You referred to it earlier on.
Yep. So I've hidden that one. There are trajectories. So here is the Holocene status, and we left that maybe around 1950. So we are here today, and we can take some measures as humans. For climate change, this 2 centigrade Celsius thing, to still be in the good Anthropocene and not going out of the system. The system is defined by glacial and interglacial conditions, which were present for the last 2.6 million years. So we had glacial times and interglacials. We are now in an interglacial, but we are heating up that interglacial already a lot. So, the question if we go out of this good Anthropocene trajectory into the bad Anthropocene trajectory, meaning going out of this glacial-interglacial cycle to a system that we don't know, actually, to a greenhouse world where there is no ice and there will no ice ages, sorry for that, there will no ice ages in between. And that's what some people call the bad Anthropocene. I'm not a fan of this good and bad, I have to admit, but it appears from time to time in the literature. And this is the bad Anthropocene for the Earth system scientists, because they don't know about that system. We know about those systems with the glacial, interglacial, there is ice on the world, and it cools down somehow, but it melts already. And question is estimates for being within the Cretaceous are from the carbon dioxide are about 2,150, so it's not far away, not that far away for us to be in that greenhouse climate system, greenhouse Earth system, where we don't know really what will happen. So there would be, for instance, during the Cretaceous we had a sea level of about 250 meters above today's. So that's a lot. When you think all those megacities are around the coastlines, they will get flooded, 250 meters. So that's not a good Anthropocene, I think.
Any other questions?
That's a good question, not for a geologist. I think we are not in that really bad way. So there's more and more awareness, and I think the symbol of the symbol word Anthropocene gets much more attraction than climate change, global change. I think defining that would not be a bad way to make that aware. But of course, the political side of that, I just read a really good essay of a geomorphologist, geographer, and a social science geographer, and they were discussing about the Anthropocene. And they were discussing about the politics that this is already post-politics or anti-politics, because there's specialists say, okay, we have to go that way, and the politics can only say yes, but nothing else. that's not my science, I have to admit.
Are you discussing also the name, or is it simply fix that it, if it comes, it's an Anthropocene, or is that because of these political impacts or of this public knowledge about it already,
yeah,
or is
yeah,
it
sure.
simply that geography is pleased that
we are just asked to think about Anthropocene. We were not asked to think about Capitalocene.
Who
like
asked
that.
You to think about the Anthropocene?
Good question. Yeah.
Oh,
I cannot answer that, really.
Oh,
I have to admit.
And you're not at all thinking about the name for it. I mean, okay.
No, that's not a real issue, because we are looking on the record, on the rock record, and if others want to call it Capitalocene or Homogenocene, it's okay for us. But most of the papers have this Anthropocene, and from my side, I think it's good to that there is the well. Human influence. I understand that social sciences are totally against that, maybe, with all the capitalism and things like that, the Industrial Revolution and the white Europeans that led that. But that's not an issue for a geologist. So why is the Cretaceous called the Cretaceous? Okay. Somebody invented the name and said, okay, these rocks look like Kreide.
But what
so
is, I mean, I would expect that you are discussing about the evidence as a name. You know, you're looking for a spike and you had plutonium, something like that. Maybe it's the most successful candidate. So it's why don't you think about having this spike or the evidence in the name as the Pleistocene and all the others?
That's not geology.
Oh.
So the marker, the spike, is only discussed between specialists if we take a fossil or we take another fossil, but the stage itself is not named after the fossil. It's named after the typical rocks that you see. For instance, the Cretaceous, the Kreidefelsen, so the rock was called Kreide before there was a Cretaceous stage. And from that rock name, there came the stage name. So I think this is a good connection, having this Anthropo thing. And we have, if we look at the rocks of the Anthropocene, we see those anthropogenic influence. So that's okay for me. Geologists are sometimes very plain and pragmatic. Sorry.
And are there some real political influences on this Anthropocene working group?
Yeah.
Yes?
As long as I haven't read this geographer piece, I would have said no, but of course there is. So the way the Anthropocene working group, the members were chosen, is already politics, of course. Because there are a lot of UK people, there are a lot of Americans. There is only one African. There are not so much women, I have to admit, within that. So that's already somehow politics. There is no real direct pressure on that, of course. Nobody from the politics came to the Cape Town Congress and said, what's with the Anthropocene? Why aren't you further? But I think there is political issues, and there is there are people that are in the Earth system sciences, and they already have their Anthropocene, so they don't really care if we define it or not, and there's a big pressure by them, of course, then on the real geologists, define it. It's here.
But if they don't. I mean, what would geology need the term for Anthropocene then?
Yeah, that's a good question of a lot of geologists that ask that. But my approach is that we have geological maps, and those units, those time units, are coming from the geological map, from the mapping. So we are mapping different kind of rocks, and then without knowing how old they are. And only later on we know, okay, that's Cretaceous and that's Tertiary and that's Triassic. And there are those anthropogenic deposits already on the maps. So they are mining waste deposits since long times. It's at least bronze time. There are all those changed soils from Romans and up to recent soils. There is the archaeological record, which is also anthropogenic. So I think that should be included in the Anthropocene. And then it makes sense for the geologist, for the plain mapping geologist, if he can say, okay, those is Holocene, and then we have this rubbish above that, the buried waste disposal, for instance, and that's Anthropocene. So I'm not so happy with the 1950 age or 1960, because that would mean Sylvester 1949 would still be Holocene, and the 1st January of 1950 is Anthropocene. So for a geologist, it doesn't make so much sense.
But I mean, geology is also the science about learn people to how to drill or to tunneling and things like that.
Yeah, that's applied geology. We are more on the science part.
Yeah, there's this science part, you know, but there is another part. You mentioned, for example, human-made earthquakes.
Yeah.
I mean, it's very clear that without any geological science, nobody would have the idea or the knowledge how to do it. Yeah. So, is it maybe if you officially are announcing the Anthropocene that there maybe is a change also in thinking about it or having more influence on those decisions to?
Not directly, but I think there is a growing awareness of that problems. But yeah, there is still the big oil business that a lot of geologists go into that, earn the money and live with that. So it will take time in that respect. And that's maybe also some reason why geologists are very conservative in changing names, especially changing to the Anthropocene. Maybe included in those discussions without naming it, but there may be the feeling of that.
Okay. Maybe other questions or... No?
What? It's really fascinating to get an insight into how the working group operates and then how that relates to the broader geological community. Has the thought that the creation of a perceptible Anthropocene on Earth might have applications for SETI been a subject of conversation or discussion at any of the meetings of the working group?
I have to admit, I didn't get the question really right.
Oh, I guess my question is really, given that we're creating a geological layer that potentially indicates sentient life, sorry, has there been any discussion of how this might be applied to looking for some kind of signature of sentient life on exoplanets or... elsewhere in the solar system?
There is a paper on the technosphere, and there are papers on the technosphere, and they deal with that in some respects, that the technosphere is already present on the Moon and coming now to Mars. But it's not really in the discussions because, it's too marginal for the geologists. I have to admit that. But it's
but there. Like the layer of the space chunk is not a layer for you, geologists.
It was named in those technosphere, technofossil publications, but I was not part of that.
Yeah, then thanks very much again, Michael Wagreich. I think we are finished for today, but we have some snacks over there. And we hope you join us again and maybe have some questions and dialogues with something to drink. And thanks very much. See you tomorrow. Um.